A brief biographical sketch from the book, Beethoven, The Man and the Artist, as revealed in his own words, read by Stephen Hawking, computer voice. This book, along with Beethoven's Letters Volumes 1 and 2 and many other free public domain books, can be found at the website below. http://www.gutenberg.org/wiki/main_page. Thanks to all of my YouTube friends, subscribers, and to YouTube for inspiring me to continue making, recording, editing, and sharing videos. YouTube forever.
Brief biographical sketch. Ludwig van Beethoven, 1770-1827, is widely considered to be one of the preeminent classical music figures of the Western world. This German musical genius created numerous works that are firmly entrenched in the repertoire. Except for a weakness in composing, vocal and operatic music, to which he himself admitted, notwithstanding a few vocal works like the opera Fidelio and the song Adelaide, Beethoven had complete mastery of the art form. He left his stamp in 9 symphonies, 5 piano concertos, 10 violin sonatas, 32 piano sonatas, numerous string quartets, and dozens of other key works. Many of his works are ingeniously imaginative and innovated, such as his 3rd symphony, the Eroica, his 9th violin sonata, the Kreutzer, his Waldstein piano sonata, his 4th and 5th piano concertos, or his Grossfuge for string quartet. Of course, many of his works have their own unique character and innovative angle to them. Comparing one to another risks comparing apples to oranges, since each adds its own detail to Beethoven's grand musical paradigm. It is difficult to sum up briefly what his musical works represent or symbolize, since taken together they encompass a vast system of thought. Generally, however, those who apprehend his music sense that it reflects their own personal yearnings and sufferings. It egoistically, and always intelligently, discusses with its listener his or her feelings in the wake of personal failure and personal triumph, from the lowest depths of despair to the highest heights of happy or triumphant fulfillment. In his music, he represents the feelings felt by those attempting to achieve their yearnings within their societies. In a thematic sense, Beethoven does not promote anarchist ideas. The listener cannot, in listening to Beethoven's music, apprehend ideas which, if applied, would compromise the welfare of his society. The music is thus civically responsible, as is the music of Bach or Mozart. For Beethoven, the society exists as a bulwark with which the individual must function in harmony, or at least not function such as to harm or destroy it. And, should the society marginalize or hurt the individual, as it often does, the individual must, according to Beethoven, humbly accept this, never considering the alternative act of attempting to harm or destroy the society in the wake of his or her personal frustrations. But, thanks to Beethoven, such an individual is provided with the means to soothe his or her misery in the wake of feeling hurt at the hands of society. The means is this music and the euphoric pleasure that it can provide to minds possessing the psycho-intellectual wiring needed to apprehend it. The following book consists of brief biographical commentaries about Beethoven, each followed by sections of quotations attributed to the muse. In these quotes, Beethoven demonstrates his intense preoccupation, or obsession, with thinking artistically and intelligently, and with helping to alleviate man's suffering by providing man with musical artworks that could enlighten him so as to become educated enough to pull himself out of his misery. He felt immediate strong disdain at any artistic statement that was not truly intelligent and artistic, such as the music of Rossini. Although not prudish, he had high standards when it came to marriage, and was morally against reproductory pleasure for its own sake, or any form of adultery. He never married. Interestingly, experimental psychologists have discovered that people who have an intense love of humanity, or are preoccupied with working to serve humanity tend to have difficulty forming intimate bonds with people on a personal level. Concerning art, Beethoven's relation to art might almost be described as personal. Art was his goddess to whom he made petition, to whom he rendered thanks, whom he defended. He praised her as his savior in times of despair. By his own confession, it was only the prospect of her comforts that prevented him from laying violent hands on himself. Read his words and you shall find that it was his art that was his companion in his wanderings through field and forest, the sharer of the solitude to which his deafness condemned him. The concepts nature and art were intimately bound up in his mind. His lofty and idealistic conception of art led him to proclaim the purity of his goddess with the hot zeal of a priestly fanatic. Every form of pseudo or bastard art stirred him with hatred to the bottom of his soul, hence his furious onslaughts on mere virtuosity, and all efforts from influential sources to utilize art for other than purely artistic purposes. And his art rewarded his devotion richly. She made his sorrowful life worth living with gifts of purest joy. To Beethoven, music was not only a manifestation of the beautiful, an art, it was akin to religion. He felt himself to be a prophet, a seer. All the misanthropy engendered by his unhappy relations with mankind could not shake his devotion to this ideal which had sprung into Beethoven from truest artistic apprehension, and been nurtured by enforced introspection and philosophic reflection. Love of nature. Beethoven was a true son of the Rhine in his love for nature. As a boy, he had taken extended trips, sometimes occupying days, with his father through the Rhenish localities everlastingly dear to me. In his days of physical health, nature was his instructress in art. "I may not come without my banner," he used to say when he set out upon his wanderings, even in his latest years, and never without his notebooks. In the scenes of nature he found his marvelous motives and themes. Brook, birds and trees sang to him. In a few special cases he has himself recorded the fact. But when he was excluded more and more from communion with his fellow men, because of his increasing deafness, until, finally, he could communicate only by writing with others, hence the conversation books, which will be cited often in this little volume, he fled for refuge to nature. Out in the woods he again became naively happy. To him the woods were a holy of holies, a home of the mysteries. Forest and mountain vale heard his sighs. There he unburdened his heavy-laden heart. When his friends need comfort, he recommends a retreat to nature. Nearly every summer he leaves hot and dusty Vienna, and seeks a quiet spot in the beautiful neighborhood. To call a retired, and reposeful little spot his own, is his burning desire. Concerning texts. Not even a Beethoven was spared the tormenting question of texts for composition. It is fortunate for posterity that he did not exhaust his energies in setting an efficient libretti, that he did not believe that good music would suffice to command success in spite of bad texts. The majority of his works belong to the field of purely instrumental music. Beethoven often gave expression to the belief that words were a less capable medium of proclamation for feelings than music. Nevertheless, it may be observed that he looked upon an opera, or lyric drama, as the crowning work of his life. He was in communication with the best poets of his time concerning opera texts. A letter of his on the subject was found in the blood-spotted pocketbook of Theodore Comer. The conclusion of his creative labors was to be a setting of Guy's Faust. Except Fidelio, however, he gave us no opera. His songs are not many, although he sought carefully for appropriate texts. Unhappily, the gift of poetry was not vouchsafed him. On composing. Wiseacres not infrequently accused Beethoven of want of regularity in his compositions. In various ways, and at divers times, he gave vigorous utterance to his opinions of such pedantry. He was not the most tractable of pupils, especially in Vienna, where, although he was highly praised as a player, he took lessons in counterpoint from Albrechtsberger. He did not endure long with Papa Haydn. He detested the study of fugue in particular. The fugue was to him a symbol of narrow coercion which choked all emotion. Mere formal beauty, moreover, was nothing to him. Over and over again he emphasizes soul, feeling, direct and immediate life, as the first necessity of an artwork. It is therefore not strange that under certain circumstances he ignored conventional forms in sonata and symphony. An irrepressible impulse toward freedom is the most prominent peculiarity of the man and artist Beethoven. Nearly all of his observations, no matter what their subject, radiate the word liberty. In his remarks about composing, there is a complete exposition of his method of work. I carry my thoughts about me for a long time, often a very long time, before I write them down. Meanwhile, my memory is so faithful that I am sure never to forget, not even in years, a theme that has once occurred to me. I change many things, discard, and try again until I am satisfied. Then, however, there begins in my head the development in every direction, and, inasmuch as I know exactly what I want, the fundamental idea never deserts me, it arises. Before me, grows, I see and hear the picture in all its extent, and dimensions stand before my mind like a cast, and there remains for me nothing but the labor of writing it down, which is quickly accomplished, when I have the time, for I sometimes take up other work, but never to the confusion of one with the other. You will ask me, where I get my ideas. That I cannot tell you with certainty, they come unsummoned. Directly, indirectly, I could seize them with my hands, out in the open air, in the woods, while walking, in the silence of the nights, early in the morning, incited by moods, which are translated by the poet into words, by me into tones that sound, and roar and storm about me until I have set them down in notes. Said to Louis Schlosser, a young musician, whom Beethoven honored with his friendship in 1822-23. On performing music. While reading Beethoven's views on the subject of how music ought to be performed, it is but natural to inquire about his own manner of playing. On this point Reis, his best pupil, reports. In general, Beethoven played his own compositions very capriciously, yet he adhered, on the whole, strictly to the beat and only at times, but seldom, accelerated the tempo a trifle. Occasionally he would retard the tempo in a crescendo, which produced a very beautiful and striking effect. While playing he would give a passage, now in the right hand, now in the left, a beautiful expression which was simply inimitable. But it was rarely indeed that he added a note or an ornament. Of his playing when still a young man, one of his hearers said that it was in the slow movements, particularly, that it charmed everybody. Almost unanimously his contemporaries give him the palm for his improvisations. Reis says, his extemporizations were the most extraordinary things that one could hear. No artist that I ever heard came at all near the height which Beethoven attained. The wealth of ideas which forced themselves on him, the caprices to which he surrendered himself, the variety of treatment, the difficulties, were inexhaustible. His playing was not technically perfect. He let many a note fall under the table, but without marring the effect of his playing. Concerning this we have a remark of his own in number 75. Somewhat critical is Czerny's report. Extraordinary as his extempore playing was, it was less successful in the performance of printed compositions, for, since he never took the time, or had the patience to practice anything, his success depended mostly on chance and mood. And since, also, his manner of playing as well as composing was ahead of his time, the weak and imperfect pianofortes of his time could not withstand his gigantic style. It was because of this that Hummel's purling and brilliant manner of play, well adapted to the period, was more intelligible and attractive to the great public. but Beethoven's playing in adagios and legato, in a sustained style, made an almost magical impression on every ear, and, so far as I know, it has never been surpassed. Czerny's remark about the pianofortes of Beethoven's day explains Beethoven's judgment on his own pianoforte sonatas. He composed for the sonorous pianoforte of the future, the pianoforte building today. The following anecdote, told by Czerny, will be read with pleasure. Pleyel, a famous musician, came to Vienna from Paris in 1805, and had his latest quartets performed in the palace of Prince Lobkowitz. Beethoven was present, and was asked to play something. As usual, he submitted to the interminable entreaties, and finally was dragged almost by force to the pianoforte by the ladies. Angrily he tears the second violin part of one of the Pleyel quartets from the music stand, where it still lay open, throws it upon the rack of the pianoforte, and begins to improvise. We had never heard him extemporize more brilliantly, with more originality or more grandly than on that evening. But throughout the entire improvisation there ran in the middle voices, like a thread, or cantus firmus, the insignificant notes, wholly insignificant in themselves, which he found on the page of the quartet, which by chance, lay open on the music stand. On them he built up the most daring melodies and harmonies, in the most brilliant concert style. Old Pleyel could only give expression to his amazement by kissing his hands. After such improvisations Beethoven was wont to break out into a loud and satisfied laugh. Czerny says further of his playing, in rapidity of scale passages, trills, leaps, etc., no one equaled him, not even Hummel. His attitude at the pianoforte was perfectly quiet and dignified, with no approach to grimace, except to bend down a little towards the keys as his deftness increased. His fingers were very powerful, not long, and broadened at the tips by much playing, for he told me often that in his youth he had practiced stupendously, mostly till past midnight. In teaching he laid great stress on the correct position of the fingers, according to the Immanuel Bach method, in which he instructed me, he himself could barely span a tenth. He made frequent use of the pedal, much more frequently than is indicated in his compositions. His reading of the scores of Handel and Gluck, and the fugues of Bach was unique, inasmuch as he put a polyphony and spirit into the former which gave the works a new form. In his later years the deaf master could no longer hear his own playing, which therefore came to have a pitifully painful effect. Concerning his manner of conducting, Seyfried says, it would no wise do to make our master a model in conducting, and the orchestra had to take great care lest it be led astray by its mentor, for he had an eye only for his composition, and strove unceasingly by means of manifold gesticulations, to bring out the expression which he desired. Often when he reached a forte he gave a violent downbeat, even if the note were an unaccented one. He was in the habit of marking a diminuendo, by crouching down lower and lower, and at a pianissimo he almost crept under the stand. With a crescendo he too, grew, rising as if out of a stage trap, and with the entrance of a fortissimo he stood on his toes, and seemed to take on gigantic proportions, while he waved his arms about, as if trying to soar upwards to the clouds. Everything about him was an activity, not a part of his organization remained idle, and the whole man seemed like a perpetuum mobile. Concerning expression, the little nuances, the equable division of light and shade, as also an effective tempo rubato, he was extremely exact, and gladly discussed them with the individual members of the orchestra without showing vexation or anger. Beethoven as critic. The opinion of artist on artists is a dubious quantity. Recall the startling criticisms of Bachlin on his associates in art made public by the memoirs of his friends after his death. Such judgments are often one-sided, not without prejudice, and mostly the expression of impulse. It is a different matter when the artist speaks about the disciples of another art than his own, even if the opinions which Buckland and Wagner held of each other are not a favorable example. Where Beethoven speaks of other composers, we must read with clear and open eyes. But even here there will be much with which we can be in accord, especially his judgment on Rossini, whom he hated so intensely, and whose airy, sense-bewitching art seduced the Viennese from Beethoven. Interesting and also characteristic of the man is the attitude which he adopted towards the poets of his time. In general, he estimated his contemporaries as highly as they deserved. On education. Beethoven's observations on this subject were called out by his experiences in securing an education for his nephew Karl, son of his like-named brother, a duty which devolved on him on the death of his brother in the winter of 1815. He loved his nephew almost to idolatry, and hoped that he would honor the name of Beethoven in the future. But there was a frivolous vein in Karl, inherited probably from his mother, who was on easy footing with morality both before and after her husband's death. She sought with all her might to rid her son of the guardianship of his uncle. Karl was sent to various educational institutions, and to these Beethoven sent many letters containing advice and instructions. The nephew grew to be more and more a care, not wholly without fault, of the master. His passionate nature led to many quarrels between the two, all of which were followed by periods of extravagant fondness. Karl neglected his studies, led a frivolous life, was fond of billiards and the coffee houses which were then generally popular, and finally, in the summer of 1826, made an attempt at suicide in the Hellenental near Baden, which caused his social ostracism. When he was found, he cried out, "I went to the bad, because my uncle wanted to better me." Beethoven succeeded in persuading Baron von Stutterheim, commander of an infantry regiment at Eglet, to accept him as an aspirant for military office. In later life he became a respected official and man. So Beethoven himself was vouchsafed only an ill-regulated education. His dissolute father treated him now harshly, now gently. His mother, who died early, was a silent sufferer, had thoroughly understood her son, and to her his love was devotion itself. He labored unwearyingly at his own intellectual and moral advancement until his death. It seems difficult to reconcile his almost extravagant estimate of the greatest possible liberty in the development of man with his demands for strict constraint to which he frequently gives expression. But he had recognized that it is necessary to grow out of restraint into liberty. His model as a sensitive and sympathetic educator was his motherly friend, the wife of court counselor von Brüningen Bonn, of whom he once said, "She knew how to keep the insects off the blossoms." On his own disposition and character. So open-hearted and straightforward a character as Beethoven could not have pictured himself with less reserve or greater truthfulness than he did during his life. Frankness toward himself, frankness toward others, though sometimes it went to the extreme of rudeness and ill-breeding, was his motto. The joyous nature which was his as a lad, and which was not at all averse to a merry prank now and then, underwent a change when he began to lose his hearing. The dread of deafness and its consequences drove him nearly to despair, so that he sometimes contemplated suicide. Increasing hardness of hearing gradually made him reserved, morose and gloomy. With the progress of the malady his disposition and character underwent a decided change, a fact which may be said to account for the contradictions in his conduct and utterances. It made him suspicious, distrustful. In his later years he imagined himself cheated and deceived in the most trifling matters by relatives, friends, publishers, servants. Nevertheless, Beethoven's whole soul was filled with a high idealism which penetrated through the miseries of his daily life. It was full, too, of a great love toward humanity in general, and his unworthy nephew in particular. Towards his publishers he often appeared covetous and grasping, seeking to rake and scrape together all the money possible, but this was only for the purpose of assuring the future of his nephew. At the same time, in the very moment, he would load down his table with all that kitchen and cellar could provide, for the reflection of his friends. Thus he oscillated continuously between two extremes, but the power which swung the pendulum was always the oral malady. He grew peevish and capricious towards his best friends, rude, even brutal at times in his treatment of them, only in the next moment, to overwhelm them most pathetically with attentions. Till the end of his life he remained a sufferer from his passionate disposition over which he gradually obtained control until, at the end, one could almost speak of a sunny clarification of his nature. He has heedlessly been accused of having led a dissolute life, of having been an intemperate drinker. There would be no necessity of contradicting such a charge, even if there were a scintilla of evidence to support it. A drinker is not necessarily a dishonorable man, least of all a musician who drinks. But, the fact of the matter, is that it is not true. If once Beethoven wrote a merry note about merrymaking with friends, let us rejoice that occasions did sometimes occur, though but rarely, when the heart of the sufferer was temporarily gladdened. He was a strict moralist, as is particularly evidenced by the notes in his journal which have not been made public. In many things which befell him in his daily life he was as ingenuous as a child. His personality, on the whole, presented itself in such a manner as to invite the intellectual and social Philistine to call him a fool. I shall print a request in all the newspapers that henceforth all artists refrain from painting my picture without my knowledge. I never thought that my own face would bring me embarrassment. About 1803, to Christine Girardi, because without his knowledge a portrait of him had been made somewhere, in a cafe, probably. God. Beethoven was through and through a religious man, though not in the confessional sense. Reared in the Catholic faith he early attained to an independent opinion on religious things. It must be borne in mind that his youth fell in the period of enlightenment and rationalism. When at a later date he composed the Grand Mass in honor of his esteemed pupil Archduke Rudolf, he hoped to obtain from him a chapelmastership when the Archduke became Archbishop of Olmütz, but in vain, he gave it forms and dimensions which deviated from the ritual. In all things liberty was the fundamental principle of Beethoven's life. His favorite book was Sturm's Observations Concerning God's Works in Nature, Betrachtungen über die Werke Gottes in der Natur, which he recommended to the priests for wide distribution among the people. He saw the hand of God in even the most insignificant natural phenomenon. God was to him the supreme being whom he had jubilantly hymned in the choral portion of the Ninth Symphony in the words of Schiller. Brothers, beyond whose starry canopy there must dwell a loving father. Beethoven's relationship to God was that of a child toward his loving father to whom he confides all his joys as well as sorrows. It is said that once he narrowly escaped excommunication for having said that Jesus was only a poor human being and a Jew. Haydn, ingenuously pious, is reported to have called Beethoven an atheist. He consented to the calling in of a priest on his deathbed. Eyewitnesses testify that the customary function was performed most impressively and edifyingly, and that Beethoven expressed his thanks to the officiating priest with heartiness. After he had left the room, Beethoven said to his friends, "Plaudite, amici, comedia finita est," the phrase with which antique dramas were concluded. From this fact the statement has been made that Beethoven wished to characterize the sacrament of extreme unction as a comedy. This is contradicted, however, by his conduct during its administration. It is more probable that he wished to designate his life as a drama. In this sense, at any rate, the words were accepted by his friends. Schindler says emphatically, "The last days were in all respects remarkable, and he looked forward to death with truly Socratic wisdom and peace of mind. I append a description of the death scene as I found it in the notebooks of A.W. Thayer, which were placed in my hands for examination after the death of Beethoven's greatest biographer in 1897. June 5, 1860, I was in Graz and saw Hewitt Enbrenner, Anselm, who gave me the following particulars: In the winter of 1826-27, his friends wrote him from Vienna that if he wished to see Beethoven again alive, he must hurry thither from Graz. He hastened to Vienna, arriving a few days before Beethoven's death. Early in the afternoon of March 26, Hewitt Enbrenner went into the dying man's room. He mentioned as persons whom he saw there, Stephen V. Bruning and Gerhard, Schindler, Telscher, and Karl's mother. This seems to be a mistake, i.e. if Mrs. V. Beethoven is right. Beethoven had then long been senseless. Telscher began drawing the dying face of Beethoven. This grated on Bruning's feelings, and he remonstrated with him, and he put up his papers and left parenthesis. Then Bruning and Schindler left to go out to Worring to select a grave. Just after the five, I got this from Bruning himself. When it grew dark with the sudden storm, Gerhard, who had been standing at the window, ran home to his teacher. Afterward, Gerhard V.B. went home, and there remained in the room only Hewitt Enbrenner and Mrs. Van Beethoven. The storm passed over, covering the glasses with snow and sleet. As it passed away, a flash of lightning lighted up everything. This was followed by an awful clap of thunder. Hewitt Enbrenner had been sitting on the side of the bed sustaining Beethoven's head, holding it up with his right arm. His breathing was already very much impeded, and he had been for hours dying. At this startling, awful peal of thunder, the dying man suddenly raised his head from Hewitt Enbrenner's arm, stretched out his own right arm majestically, like a general giving orders to an army. This was but for an instant. The arm sunk back. He fell back. Beethoven was dead. Another talk with Hewitt Enbrenner. It seems that Beethoven was at his last gasp, one eye already closed. At the stroke of lightning and the thunder peal, he raised his arm with a doubled up fist. The expression of his eyes and face was that of one defying death, a look of defiance and power of resistance. He must have had his arm under the pillow. I must ask him. I did ask him. He had his arm around B's neck. H.E.K. Appendix. Some observations may finally be acceptable touching Beethoven's general culture, to which the thoughts of the reader must naturally have been directed by the excerpts from his writings set forth in the preceding pages. His own words betray the fact that he was not privileged to enjoy a thorough school training, and was thus compelled to the end of his days to make good the deficiencies in his learning. As a lad at Bonn, he had attended the so-called Tirocinium, a sort of preparatory school for the gymnasium, and acquired a small knowledge of Latin. Later he made great efforts to acquire French, a language essential to intercourse in the upper circles of society. He never established intimate relations with the rules of German. He used small initials for substantives, or capitalized verbs and adjectives according as they appeared important to him. His punctuation was arbitrary. Generally he drew a perpendicular line between his words, letting it suffice for a comma or period as the case might be, a proceeding which adds not a little to the embarrassments of him who seeks to translate his sometimes mystical utterances. It is said that a man's bookcase bears evidence of his education and intellectual interests. Beethoven also had books, not many, but a characteristic collection. From his faithful friend and voluntary servant Schindler we have a report on this subject. Of the books of which he was possessed at the time of his death, there have been preserved 4 volumes of translations of Shakespeare's works: Homer's Odyssey in the translation of J.H. Voss, Sturm's Observations, several times referred to in the preceding pages, and Guy's Wastostlichen Divan. These books are frequently marked and annotated in lead pencil, thus bearing witness to the subjects which interested Beethoven. from them, and volumes which he had borrowed. Many passages were copied by him into his daily journal. Besides these books, Schindler mentions Homer's Iliad, Goethe's poems, Wilhelm Meister and Faust, Schiller's dramas and poems, Tiege's Urania, volumes of poems by Matthiessen and Zum, and Nina de Bigny's letters to Natalia on singing, a book to which Beethoven attached great value. These books have disappeared, as well as others which Beethoven valued. We do not know what became of the volumes of Plato, Aristotle, Plutarch, and Xenophon, or the writings of Pliny, Euripides, Quintilian, Ovid, Horace, Ossian, Milton, and Thomson, traces of which are found in Beethoven's utterances. The catalogue made for the auction sale of his posthumous effects on September 7, 1827, included 44 works of which the censorship seized 5 as prohibited writings, namely, Zum's Foot Journey to Syracuse, the Apocrypha, Kotzebue's On the Nobility, W. E. Muller's Paris in its Zenith, 1816, and Views on Religion and Ecclesiasticism. Burney's General History of Music was also in his library, the gift, probably of an English admirer. In his later years, Beethoven was obliged to use the oft-quoted conversation books in his intercourse with friends and strangers alike who wrote down their questions. Of these little books, Schindler preserved no less than 134, which are now in the Royal Library in Berlin. Naturally, Beethoven answered the written questions orally as a rule. An idea of Beethoven's opinions can occasionally be gathered from the context of the questions, but frequently we are left in the dark. Beethoven's own characterization of his deafness as singular is significant. Often, even in his later years, he was able to hear a little, and for a time. One might almost speak of a periodical visitation of the demon. In his biography, Marx gives the following description of the malady. As early as 1816 it is found that he is incapable of conducting his own works. In 1824 he could not hear the storm of applause from a great audience. But in 1822 he still improvises marvelously in social circles. In L856 he studies their parts in the Ninth Symphony, and Solemn Mass with Sontag and Unger, and in 1835 he listens critically to a performance of the quartet in A minor, Opus 132. It is to be assumed that in such urgent cases his willpower temporarily gave new tension to the gradually atrophying oral nerves. It is said that he was still able to hear single or a few voices with his left ear, but could not apprehend masses. But this was not the case in less important moments, as the conversation books prove. In these books a few answers are also written down, naturally enough in cases not intended for the ears of strangers. At various times Beethoven kept a diary in which he entered his most intimate thoughts, especially those designed for his own encouragement. Many of these appear in the preceding pages. In these instances more than in any others his expressions are obscure, detached, and, through indifference, faulty in construction. For the greater part they are remarks thrown upon the paper in great haste. End of Project Gutenberg text. Beethoven, the man and the artist. As revealed in his own words, by Ludwig van Beethoven. Edited by Friedrich Kirst and Henry Edward Krebiel.